sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to learn about the best companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward each and every one of you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from us. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us leave this gathering, except that we have been forgiven. Please say Ameen. So this talk was difficult for me to prepare, to be honest with you. There's so much when you think about the life of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that is so much information there that it's not enough to talk about him within an hour and a half. Even if some of you watched series on him before, you know some of the lecture things about him, there's people that will talk about him for 6 to 10 to 15 hours. One of the lectures that inspired me, which was years ago, was about 14 hours, right? So when I would be driving to school when I was in college at that time, I would listen to about half hour, hour a day. And then sometimes, because it was CDs, right? I had CD in my car. Sometimes the CD, it would skip one of the parts, so I'd have to re-listen to some of the parts, right? But it was about 14 to 15 hours. So there's so much information and not enough time to talk about it. But inshallah, we're going to do the best we can. So I did not want to just make this a bibliography, you would say, just talking about his family and what he did. But at the same time, I did not want to leave some of that information out. Okay, I did not want to leave some of that information out. So I combined it, and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it easy for me today. This talk will not give justice to the life of the Siddiq, radiallahu anhu. It will not give justice. But as one of my teachers told me, I want to talk about him today to try to inspire you to find a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, whether it's a Sahabi or a Sahabiya, that can relate, that you can relate to from your personality and learn about them, right? And connect with them and see what were their strengths and then see what were their weaknesses, right? And how you can apply those situations to your own personal life. We all need to have a role model in our lives. We all need to have them. And the proper role models for us are not the soccer players, right? A lot, especially with the World Cup going on, you have a lot of people spending time with World Cup, for example. So you have soccer players that they love. Or maybe you have a sports player that you're a fan of. Or maybe you have a singer. Or maybe you have this. Or you maybe have that, right? Those are not the proper role models for us. The most proper role model for us is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after that, it's his companions, as he has mentioned to us sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the person who we are talking about today is someone, when you look at his life, it's as if he was created for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam specifically. And every time I mention the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, please try your best to say sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Always try to remember that, because that will make you be the people that's closer to him. This is a person that, like I said, it seems like he was created specifically to serve the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, someone who loved the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than he loved himself. Someone who was an advisor, someone who was a friend, someone who was a family member, someone who was a confidant that the Prophet ﷺ would tell him his secrets, someone who the Prophet ﷺ loved very much. Abdullah reported that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that لو كنت متخذا من أهل الأرض خليلا لاتخذت ابن أبي قحافة خليلا ولكن صاحبكم خليل الله. That if I had someone that I could choose to be my bosom friend, my khalil, right? Someone that is a very close, intimate friend, it would be Abu Bakr. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen your companion as his friend. Who is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen him as a friend. This is a man who, Umar, Sayyidina Umar, that we hear so many great stories about, radiallahu anhu, who said, I wish I was a hair on the chest of Abu Bakr. This is Sayyidina Umar saying, I wish I was a piece of hair on the chest of Sayyidina Abu Bakr. This is a man that Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sayyidina Ali said, kana sabbaqan li kulli khair. Everything about Sayyidina Abu Bakr was good. Everything about him was good. Huwa sabbaq. You know, he was always the first. He was always the one that tried to do the best. This is a man that the son of Ali bin Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, Muhammad bin Hanafiyya, he said, I asked my father, who are the best people after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Qala Abu Bakr. قلت ثم من قال ثم عمر وخشيت أن يقول عثمان قلت ثم أنت قال ما أنا إلا رجل من المسلمين. Subhanallah, the humble approach that they used to take, the companions of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took. But what did Ali bin Abi Talib radiallahu anhu say? He said that Abu Bakr. Then after that, he said his son said then who? Then he said Umar. Then he said, I feared that he was going to say Uthman, so I said, is it you? And he said, no, I am just a man from the Muslimin. I am just an ordinary man from the Muslimin. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. This is a man that, unlike any other Sahaba, he would give fatwas during the time of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Narrated by Jubair bin Mu'tim, that one woman came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to speak to him about something. Then he ordered her with something and she said, what should I do, O Messenger of Allah, if I do not find you? He said, فَإِن لَمْ تَجِدِينِي فَأْتِي أَبَا بَكْرِ. That if you do not find me, then go to Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. So he used to give fatwas at the time that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive. This is a man that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is no one that did us a favor except that I have repaid them for it, except Abu Bakr. And Allah will repay him on the day of judgment. So every other companion, every other person that did a favor to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he has repaid him in this world. But Abu Bakr will be repaid by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a man that asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will anybody be called from all the gates of Jannah? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, and I hope you are one of them. That I hope you are one of them. That every single gate from paradise will call the name of Abu Bakr, arguing for him to walk through that gate so that they can have that honor. This, the man that we will be discussing today is no other than the greatest companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first man that will go into Jannah after the Prophets alayhi musallat wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So to understand a little bit about a person, we need to kind of understand his lineage. We need to understand his family, and we need to understand who he really is from his birth and some details. One thing I really want to emphasize and get us all to understand is the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when you have these four that inshallah will be talked about in the upcoming weeks, we want people to understand that what made them great was that they were normal human beings like us. That they had sins, that they had desires, that they had wants, that they had needs. Right? But what did they do? They raced towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is what made them great. It's not that they were angels. It's not that they were someone specific, right? That the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, oh, you're going to Jannah, you're going to Jannah, you're going to Jannah, right? It's not just like that. Yes, even though we have hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, these people are going to Jannah. But that was not their case for their lives. That was not the reasons that they lived their lives. They lived their lives as normal human beings that made mistakes, that made sins, but they were the ones that repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if we want to be great like these men and women, then we have to follow the same path. We cannot try to take a different path than the sunnah of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and think that we will be successful. We cannot take a different path. We have to take the path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So like I said, they were people that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them that this was wrong or that was wrong, what would they say? They would say, sami'na wa ata'na. We hear and we obey. How many of us today, when we hear something, we go and try to challenge it right away? How many of us, when we have some type of fiqh issue, where there's a difference of opinion, right? We try to always take the easiest route. How many of us, we try to argue and try to make everything ourselves understand everything in a logical manner? How many of us are like that, right? How many of us have a hard time believing in the ilmul ghayb, in the unseen? That's because our imans are not at that point yet where we need them to be, right? We have to work, we have to strive, we have to push, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make everything easy for us. The other point I want to mention is let's not come in here with the intention just to listen to a lecture and then leave, right? But come in here to take some of the points, right, of the life of Sayyidina Abu Bakr and even some of the other companions as I mentioned, right? And try to implement it in our lives. That's one thing that even myself, when I go to a lecture and I sit there and I listen and I spend time, I try to contemplate that. Is that, what am I here for? What am I really trying to do? Am I going to take some lessons from this lecture and apply it in my life? Or am I just going to listen, put it in one ear, and then take it out the other? Right? So we need to try to purify intentions. And inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it easy, and He's the most merciful, and He will accept. So what is the real name of Sayyidina Abu Bakr? Does anyone know? I'm sure some of you that listen to his lecture series, right? I'm sure you know But I want to try to give somebody a chance. And unfortunately, I don't have any prizes with me. Maybe a book. I don't know if this is the library's book, though, so that'd be stealing, so I can't do that. But does anybody know the name of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, his real name? And if you know the full name, the whole name, I'll give you $100 for sure. But you can't use your phone. Because I know people did that the last time I asked a question. They use their phone. Yes, yes, Khalid.
Is it Abdul Rahman ibn Abu Sahaba?
What is it?
Abdul Rahman ibn Abu Sahaba.
You are close. It's not Abdul Rahman. Anybody else? I don't want to spend too much time at this point. Anybody else? Jazakallah. It's Abdullah. Abdullah ibn Uthman or Abdullah ibn Uthman ibn Abi Quhafa. Because his father's name is Abu Quhafa. So he is the son of Quhafa, right? So his full name is Abdullah ibn Uthman ibn Amir ibn Amr ibn Ka'b ibn Sa'd ibn Taym ibn Murra ibn Ka'b ibn Lu'ay ibn Ghalib al-Qurayshi al-Taymi. Radiallahu anhu. So that's why I said I give you $100 if you memorize it, because I don't think any of us, even myself, if you took my iPad away from me, I wouldn't memorize it. So that's okay. But I can't give myself $100. So his lineage is converged with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the sixth grandfather, Murra bin Ka'b, ibn Ka'b. Abu Bakr is a kunya, okay? So that's an honorary name that was given to him, radiallahu ta'ala an, and the word Bakr, right, refers to a young camel and was used by the Arabs as a name to be considered to be the father of a great tribe. And what tribe did Abu Bakr radiallahu an come from? I mean, this one's easy. It was from, yes, but it was from also amongst the Quraysh, right? So, was this the only name given to Abu Bakr radiallahu an? How many names do you think were given to him total? And this is obviously, there could be more, but I only found these several names. Someone wants to take a guess? And it's not like 16, like how I read, because that means he's the son of, the son of, the son of, the son of. So that's not his specific full name, right? But how many names, different names were given to Sayyidina Abu Bakr? So his real name is Abdullah ibn Uthman, right? His kunya is Abu Bakr, okay? And what other names was he given? I read some of the verses. If you're paying attention when I was reading the verses. Yes, Anis? As-Siddiq, yes, that's one. What else? No guesses? Okay. I'll be generous now. I'll move on then, because I don't want to hold you guys up. So he was also given the title of Al-Atiq, okay? And that was usually given to a person who was a slave, who was given freedom, to put it in simple terms, right? But this was a title given to him by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. According to our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said when Abu Bakr had visited him, "Be of good cheer. You are the one whom Allah has ransomed from the fire." So that you are a person who is freed from the hellfire. And this is recorded by At-Tirmidhi, right? And Shaykh Al-Bani rahmatullah alayhi graded it as sound. There could be also some more reasons, as he was someone that was very handsome, right? Radiallahu anhu. He was someone that had a long history of doing good, and or he was a previous child, no previous child of his mother had survived except Abu Bakr. So these are several reasons why he could be given the name Al-Atiq. The most famous one we know is As-Siddiq, the one who is what? Who is truthful, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. There's two reasons that we know how he got this name. The first one is when the Prophet ﷺ ascended on the mountain of Uhud, right? And he was accompanied by Abu Bakr, Umar, and Uthman. The mountain shook beneath them. The Prophet ﷺ hit it with his foot and said, "O Uhud, utbut Uhud, fama alayka illa nabiyun aw siddiqun aw shahidan." Right? That, "Oh Uhud, stop shaking, right? Or be firm, for you have none but a prophet, a siddiq, and two martyrs." And who were the two martyrs? Umar and Uthman, radiallahu anhu. The second we know is from Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. When some men came to Abu Bakr, right, they said, "Do you want to know what your companion is saying?" They come to him and they're kind of like excited. They're like, "Oh, they're going to challenge Abu Bakr. And when he hears this, he's going to be rattled," right? They said that he is claiming that he was taken to Baytul Maqdis in Jerusalem from Mecca in one night. Abu Bakr responded, That if he said that, then that is true. But what does this statement show? It shows the wisdom of Sayyidina Abu Bakr. He knew the people who were coming to him. He just did not say, oh yeah, that's true right away, right? But he used hikmah. He said, if he said it, then it is true. And they said, do you truly believe this? He responded, yes, I believe with him in regard to something more unlikely than that. I believe in him with regard to the revelation that comes from the heavens in the morning and the evening. And we believe this is another reason that he was given the name As-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Another name that he is given is As-Sahib. In the first verse that I read from Surah At-Tawbah, right? إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعْنَا. Right? And the ulama, they say that this is talking specifically about Abu Bakr, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning about the cave. And inshallah, when I get later to that point, we'll discuss it more. Another name that he is given is Al-Atqa. Al-Atqa. The one who has taqwa. The one who is righteous. We'll discuss this one later as well, inshallah. And lastly, Al-Awad. Right? Which is indicative of piety and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was narrated by Ibrahim al-Nakhai that Abu Bakr was given this title because of his kindness and his compassion. And the Prophet ﷺ said in an authentic hadith in Tirmidhi, the most compassionate of my ummah towards my ummah is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. And this is definitely a very true statement. Sadaqa Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our scholars unanimously agreed that he was born after the year of the elephant. He was raised in a good upbringing by his parents, and this is key, right? One thing, you know, for us, especially as youth, right? Our parents try to put us in the masjid at a certain age and try to tell us that we need to, that we'll be learning that way, right? We'll become better people that way. And that is true. But one thing I want to mention, right, that we need to strive ourselves. We need to strive ourselves from a young age. And we'll move on to the next point. With regards to his physical characteristics, you will be amazed as he is the total opposite of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When we hear of Umar, which will be discussed next week by Dr. Muhannad, right? We think that the Sahaba, all of them, were like 6'5", 250 pounds, 0.00025% body fat, all muscle, and they were very aggressive men. Like, all they wanted to do, right, was just like work out. Like, you see people in the gym and stuff like that, and they're just like building and trying to build their muscles all day and night, right? That's what we think all the companions look like, especially when we hear about Sayyidina Umar, right? Very tall man, and he was very tall man. He was like 6, I'm not sure his height is, we can text Dr. Muhammad and ask him. I'll text him after to find out. I'll give you some preview of next week, right? But we think that about the Sahaba. Qais ibn Abi Hazm said that I visited Abu Bakr, who was a fair and slim man. He was a fair and slim man. He was not a very tall man, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he was not fleshy. How slim was Sayyidina Abu Bakr? The Prophet ﷺ said, Allah will not look on the day of resurrection at a person who drags his garment behind him out of pride. Right? Out of pride. On that, Abu Bakr said, O Messenger of Allah, one side of my izar hangs low if I do not take care of it. The Prophet ﷺ said, you are not one of those who do it out of pride. You are not one of those that does it out of pride. So what does this show? That Sayyidina Abu Bakr, every time he would try to tie his izar, right, his cloth, it would become loose and it would fall, right? Or it would fall, and it could not fit around his waist, and it would get loose often. And this is how slim he was, Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was fair in complexion, yellowish, with a sparse beard. Some of these English terms myself, I had to go to like a dictionary to say, understand what they mean. It was like very, it's not your regular English. He had sunken eyes and a curved aquiline nose. His calves and upper legs were thin but strong. He had a prominent forehead and slender hands. He would dye his beard and his white hairs with a mixture of henna and powder and herbs. And this was reported to us from Bukhari. So as you can see, Abu Bakr was a very slender man. He was medium, right? Not short, but he was medium height, right? And he was very, you could see it on his body that his legs, arms, and even his face was very pushed in. It was thin. But he was a very handsome man, radiallahu ta'ala an. But as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at our appearance, right? This is one thing, the point that I want to mention. Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and is reported by Abu Hurairah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. Right? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, verily Allah does not look to your faces and your wealth, right? But He looks to your heart and your deeds. What we should take from this hadith and the description of Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala an, right, is that the limitations of his size, the limitations of his looks, the limitation of his age, because he was one of the older companions, the limitation of his wealth, the limitation of his health, right, it did not stop him from becoming the best. I mean, think about the ummah that we are in. We are in the ummah of the best of the creation, who is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then his companion is the number one man that will enter into Jannah after the prophets. The number one man to walk on the face of this earth after the prophets, alayhimu salatu wassalam, right? But he did not let that stop him. He did not make that as an excuse, right? So we should not think that we have limitations on what we can do for this ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and for ourselves or work or talent wise. Do not let people put you down. We should not look at ourselves and say we cannot do this or we cannot do that, right? If you have a good intention, you have good ideas, you have something that you feel like you can offer, then bring it to the table, as you would say, right? Bring it to the table and do not limit yourselves, as this did not limit Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. We have a lot of potential in this community, and especially in Michigan. I lived in other states other than Michigan, right? And I went to other masajids, and there would be only like 10 people. And subhanAllah, when you go from a community like this to another community, you get like sad. You get like depressed. No one really, you know, no one says salam to each other, no one talks, right? And then you're just like walking, you pray, you go home, and you feel like you have no community. But in Michigan, right, and especially in Canton and Dearborn, we're really blessed to have these giant communities that we can try to benefit and take benefit from. But one thing I do want to mention that is a very popular trend out of our times, right? And that's the do not judge me card. Like someone could take this hadith and say, don't judge me, you know? Don't judge me. Don't tell me what to do or things like that. No, when people advise us, right? When people try to say, try to correct us in something we're doing wrong, that is not judging, right? As Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab, he said in Bukhari, he narrated, this is an athar, he said people were sometimes judged by the revealing of a divine inspiration during the lifetime of Allah's Apostle sallallahu alayhi wasallam, but now there's no more revelation. After the passing of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there's no more revelation, right? Now we judge you by the deeds you practice publicly. So we will trust you and favor the one who does good deeds in front of us, and we will not call him to account about what he is really doing in secret. For Allah will judge him for that. For Allah will judge him or her for that. But we will not trust or believe the one who presents to us with an evil deed, even if he claims that his intentions were good. Now this does not mean that we do stuff just for showing off as well, but I'm trying to make prove a point. I'm trying to push a point across that we have a balance, right? That we just don't try to show off and try to do good in front of people, but we also do not try to condemn people to a certain way. So who was the family of the Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an? His father, as we mentioned, was Uthman ibn Amir ibn Amr, right? Who did not become a Muslim till the conquest of Mecca. His mother was Salam bin Sakht ibn Amr, also known as Umul Khair, right? And I think I messed up on the spelling of the name. But she became a Muslim early on, radiallahu anha. His wives and children, he had several. So Fatila bin Abdul Uzza was one, and she was the mother of Abdullah al-Asma. Difference of opinion if she became a Muslim or not, but they say that Sayyidina Abu Bakr divorced her in the Jahiliyyah period. You have Umm Rumman bint Amir ibn Uwaymin, mother of Abdurrahman and Aisha. You have Asma bint Umays, mother of Abdullah from a previous husband. And then when she got married to Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Muhammad was the child, their child. And then you have Habiba bint Kharija, mother of Kulthum, who was born after he had passed away, radiallahu anhu ajma'in. So this is the family of Abu Bakr. How was Sayyidina Abu Bakr pre-Islam? He was a person of high standards. He was from the most prominent tribe. He was very well known. He had a very likable personality, right? And he was a person that was favored by many people. He was an elite of the Quraysh, and he was not poor. He was not a poor man, radiallahu anhu. He was a specialist in genealogy. He could trace the lineage of people and knew about the tribes and the history and was very respectful from that. And he would not insult people's lineage, or he would not insult people in general at all. Right? Unless it was for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There are different several instances when he gets upset for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this earned the people's trust, and they knew this about him. He was well liked amongst his people, and he was known to be generous, and he had great character. This was his pre-Islam. He never drank wine, and he made it haram on himself before Islam. Does anyone know the story of why? That he made it haram on himself before his Islam. Take a guess. No guesses? Yes, that was it. So one day, he was walking, and he saw this man who was very drunk, right? And what this man had done is that he put his hand in a pile of feces, right? And he tried to eat it. Then when it would come close to his face, right? When it come close to his face, and he would get the smell, he would push it away. But then he's drunk, he's trying to eat it again. Then he gets it close to his mouth, and then he smells it, then he pushes it away. Then he repeats the same thing, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr said, this man has no idea what he's doing. This man has no idea what he's doing, and he saw the ill effects of alcohol. He never prostrated before any idol as well. He said, my father took me to this room of idols as the tradition to worship them, and he said, these are your gods. As he left me, I looked at them and said, I am hungry. Can you feed me? Right? And they gave no answer. Who else does this remind us of? This is a person in the Quran. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, right? That he was questioning the idols as well and telling his father, do they benefit you or do they harm you? Can they hear you? Can they listen to you, right? So it shows Abu Bakr was contemplating things from a young age. So as we can see, before his Islam, Abu Bakr was a well-established man. From our aspects, we would think he had everything. He was well-respected and loved. He had wealth and family. So what made Abu Bakr leave all this life, this lifestyle, and put his life on the line? What do you think made Sayyidina Abu Bakr leave all this? What do you guys think? What was missing? It's very simple. Some of the questions I ask are, to be honest, are very simple. You don't have to be shy. And if you get it wrong, it's not a problem. Thought it. What do you think? You thought it in the front. Did you listen to even the question I asked? What is it?
I don't know.
Yes. Okay, it's close enough, it's good enough. I'll take the answer. He was a man that was looking for the truth. He was a man that was looking for the truth. He was not a man that was in poverty. He was not a man that had low social class or status, right? He was not a man that was easily convinced, but he was someone that was searching for the truth, especially when he would go out on business ventures and he would see the Christians and the Jews and the different religions, right? He would go and try to study them and see if any of those were the truth, because he knew himself that his idols and the pagans that his people worshipped were not. So what does this say, especially about us, the ones that are born with Islam? The ones that are given about this blessing of Islam. What does this say about us? How much effort do we put? How much time have we put? How much have we sacrificed? Right? And this is something that I want us to think about and go from there. So now that we have a short biography and the background of the Siddiq, of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala, I want to discuss three main characteristics with no particular rank or order, as all of them were good, and as we mentioned, Abu Bakr was all good, right? كَانَ سَبَّبًا لِكُلِّ خَيْرٍ, right? Everything about him radiallahu ta'ala was good, and only talk about three characteristics does not do justice, as I mentioned earlier, as there could be 5, 10, 15, 20, and there's so many details, and all of them intertwine with each other as well. Like you can use the same hadith and athar that I'm using, right? And then take some other lesson from it. But that's the beauty of talking about our deen. That we can, all of us, we have a different understanding. All of us, we take something different. And all of us can benefit from a positive way. And this is all good. This is all good. So the first one that stood out to me, especially as we mentioned his status in society, his size and his stature, was his bravery and courage. Ibn Kathir mentions that one day, when Ali bin Abi Talib stood up to address his people, when he was the Khalifa, so this was way after the time of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, he said, O people, who is the bravest of all people? They said, you are commander of the faithful, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are the bravest of all the people. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, as for me, I defeated everyone with whom I engaged in single combat, but Abu Bakr was the bravest of all. We made a hut for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, who will stay with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, lest any of the polytheists, the mushrikeen, attack him. By Allah, none of us stayed close to him, defending him, except Abu Bakr. And every time any polytheist got close, he would be confronted with Abu Bakr, wielding his sword. He was the bravest of all people. Then Ali radiallahu ta'ala continued. He said, I saw the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he was surrounded by the Quraysh, who began pushing and shoving him around, saying, have you made gods, our gods, one God? By Allah, no Muslim stayed close to him except Abu Bakr, who struck out, hitting and pushing back, saying, woe to you, would you kill a man because he says, my Lord is Allah? أَتَقْتُلُونَ رَجُلًا أَن يَقُولُ رَبِّيَ اللَّهِ Would you kill a man just for saying that he believes Allah is his Lord? Then Ali lifted, radiallahu ta'ala, lifted his cloak that he was wearing and wept until his beard became wet. He said, I ask you by Allah, is the believer of the family of the Pharaoh better or is he Abu Bakr? Who is the believer, Mu'min Ali Fir'aun? What surah is that in them? What surah is Mu'min Ali Fir'aun in the Quran? When it talks about Mu'min Ali Fir'aun. Man, I think I asked some tough questions. I didn't plan properly. I apologize. Surah Dhafir. Okay? But the people remained silent. After a while, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, by Allah, 1 hour of Abu Bakr's time is better than a world full of people like the believer of the family of the Pharaoh. For he was a man who concealed his faith, but Abu Bakr showed it openly. And what event was Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu talking about? He's talking about two events, but we'll go into one of them. Our mother Aisha says that when the Prophet ﷺ finished speaking, Abu Bakr was the first to embrace Islam. We know that he is the first male to accept Islam. Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha is the first woman. And Ali bin Abi Talib is the first child. Okay? So they are the first three that accepted Islam. And there was no one happier between the two mountains than Muhammad at the acceptance of Abu Bakr's Islam. This is from Bidayah wa Nihayah. And what happened after Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala accepted Islam? Did he just sit back and practice his faith quietly? Did he just take all the money he had? Because he was rich from before, right? So he just could have taken all his money and then just keep it, right? And he's already high in society, he's already respected. Right? He doesn't have to worry about the other Muslims. He doesn't have to care about the other Muslims. Right? Something similar to today, right? Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed us with many things, with many blessings, right? But we have our brothers and sisters around the world who are starving, who are crying, who are being oppressed, right? We have the same situation. Did Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu just sit back? No, he did not. He said, I am ready. I have found my religion and I am ready to practice it in society. Right? So he went to the Prophet ﷺ, and the event that Sayyidina Ali radiallahu ta'ala was talking about was when the Muslims were 38 strong. So it's not 1.8 billion. This is only 38 people total. This was so beginning of the da'wah. And he went to the Prophet ﷺ and said, oh Rasulullah ﷺ, let's preach the da'wah publicly. Let's tell everybody about Islam so that we can come to Islam. The Prophet ﷺ said, yeah, Abu Bakr, but we are very few. We are very few people. And it's not that the Prophet ﷺ was scared or anything, but he was using his hikmah, right? And then Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu persisted. He's like, no, let's give it publicly. So then what happened is one day they all gathered in the masjid. They all gathered in the masjid and they told the other tribes to come. When the other tribes came, all the companions of the Prophet ﷺ sat by their own tribes, except for who? Except for Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He sat next to the Prophet ﷺ. When he sat next to the Prophet ﷺ, He was the first one to get up. He was the first one to get up and he started praising Allah and he started calling to the da'wah of Islam, to the religion of Islam. As soon as he said some of those things, the people started getting up and they started coming after him. And they started beating up all the Muslims in the masjid. They just started going after them, fighting them, punching them. And then Utba ibn Rabi', he started hitting Sayyidina Abu Bakr with his shoe. And I don't know what type of shoe it was. I couldn't get to understand the word. But it was some type of shoe that he hit him in the nose until the nose of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, you couldn't tell his face from his nose. Then he flattened his nose and they beat him unconscious, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Until his tribe, Sayyidina Abu Bakr's tribe came in and dispersed all the people. So it was a tribalistic system. So when his tribe came in, right, they fought off all the people. And they said that if Abu Bakr is killed, then we will kill Utba bin Rabi'. Right? And they hurt Sayyidina Abu Bakr very bad. After some time, they go to Sayyidina Abu Bakr and he gains conscious. What do you think are the first words that he said after he gains conscious? Take guesses. Yes, Rabia. Yes, Jazakumullah khairan. How is the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? All his people got mad at Abu Bakr. They're like, bro, you just got beat, almost beaten to death. And the first thing you get up, you don't eat, you don't drink nothing. And you ask, how is the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? They're like, what's wrong with you? What is wrong with you? But this was the love he had for the Prophet of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was the first public da'wah event in Islam in our history. And he was the first person to deliver an Islamic speech, to give a khatira or talk in our history. The second event that showed his bravery was the sacrifice when he was offered persecution. So many of the Muslims, they left to Abyssinia. And since they knew the characteristics of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, right? They said that how can a man like you, someone that keeps the relationship of the kin, of the family, someone that supports the poor, someone that helps the needy, how can someone like you be kicked out of your own land? So one of the people, one of the chieftains of the tribe, they offered him protection. Once they offered him protection, they're like, we're going to go back to the Quraysh and let them know we are protecting you, right? But they said on one condition, that you have to pray inside your house. You cannot read the Quran outside, you cannot pray outside, because every time Abu Bakr would read the Quran, would pray, and he starts reciting the verses of the Quran, he would just start crying. He would just start crying profusely, right? And people would be amazed by this. Like, what is causing this man of great status, of great nature, right, to start crying every time he does this action, this ritual, right? So they said that to him. And Abdullah, he says, I offered him protection, and they agree on this condition. Abu Bakr then took the protection. He took it for a little while, but then it started to bother him. So what did he do? After a while, he's just like, forget it. He just said, forget it. I'm going to go outside. And he started to pray. Then they said, okay, your protection is gone, right? And he said, I shall give up your protection and be content with the protection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He showed that he's not scared or worried about anything except that he gets the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third migration, the third is the migration with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As you probably have heard before, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr were put on a hit list. They were like the enemies of the state, similar to how you know the media portrays the Muslims now, right? You have a certain type of name, you're gonna be already put on a red list. You can't go and fly. If you look a certain way, you can't go and fly. If you say something in Arabic, you're gonna be kicked off a plane. Right? Similar to that, except this was worse. They were looking to kill them and execute them right away. Right? So what happened is, even though Abu Bakr knew all the risks, he was determined to go on the journey of the hijrah with the Prophet ﷺ. He asked the Prophet ﷺ that, Ya Rasulullah, do you have a companion? And the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, and it is you. Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that, I have never seen a man cry out of happiness like I've seen my father that day. I've never seen a man cry out of happiness like I seen my father did that day. So Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala accompanied the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And just because we got 2 minutes before break, I'll just translate the ayah. They went on this journey and they got to a point in the cave where Abu Bakr saw the army right on top of him. And he's like, Ya Rasulullah, only if they look down, we will be perished. Only if they look down, we will be perished. The army will capture us. And the Prophet ﷺ said, no harm will affect the two people when the third is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in that ayah that I read earlier, if you do not aid the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah has already aided him when those who disbelieved had driven him out of Mecca as one of two. When they were in the cave, and he said to his companion, do not grieve. Do not grieve. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. And Allah sent down his tranquility upon him and supported him with angels you did not see and made the word of those who disbelieved the lowest, while the word of Allah that is the highest, and Allah is exalted in might and wise. This is bravery. And one point that I want to clarify that Shaykh Ali Abdullah mentioned to me is that when Abu Bakr, he accepted to pray in his house, and then he did, he changed his mind and prayed outside, he broke a promise, right? But Shaykh Ali was telling me to explain that the promise for that type of reason can be broken, okay? And I hope that makes sense. Is that kind of clear? Because that was something that the non-Muslims were telling him to do, right? He did it, but then he broke his promise for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the sake of Islam. So the fourth event that shows his bravery, that shows his characteristics, is at the death of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So just imagine this. You love a person so much, right? You love a person so much that you spend all your time with them, right? That you, when you see them, you're happy, right? That you gain knowledge from them. That you go and you learn something from them, right? Imagine that type of person that you have even right now in your lives, right? That you would be so upset to lose. You can't even think of losing that person. That was how the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was to the companions. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, everybody was in chaos. The whole masjid was in chaos, right? When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala, the 6'5", 250, all muscle guy, grabbed his sword, and he's like, I'm gonna chop anyone's hands and feet off that said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, right? He was so angry that he didn't control it. He's like, I'm gonna chop anyone's hands and feed off that said the Prophet ﷺ died. He only went to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like Musa did, and he will come back, right? Sayyidina Uthman radiallahu ta'ala an, he couldn't even speak. He was like semi-paralyzed, radiallahu ta'ala an, right? And and all the other companions, there was chaos and confusion. And Sayyidina Aisha, our mother radiallahu ta'ala anha, she says that the Arabs apostated and the hopes of the Jews and Christians became high. Right? Hypocrisy appeared and the Muslims became like lost sheep on a dark night because of the loss of their Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What prophetic words our companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our mother Sayyidina Aisha said. So when Sayyidina Abu Bakr heard of this news, he was away. He was not in the same area as where the death occurred of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was spending time with his family away and he rode on his horse. When he rode on his horse, he came back, he went straight to his daughter's house, Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha's house, right? And he looked at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was covered, he uncovered him, he gave him a kiss on the forehead, and he said, you are pure as you were in your death, as you were pure when you were alive, right? And he wept and said, may my father and mother be sacrificed for you by Allah. Allah will not cause you to die twice. As for the death that Allah has decreed for you, you have gone through it. Then he headed into the masjid, right, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he headed into the masjid, Sayyidina Umar was still obsessed, still walking around, still talking, still going, right? And Sayyidina Abu Bakr then tells him, Umar, calm down. Like, calm down, bro. You're like going, you're upset right now, right? And you're saying things and trying to do something that you shouldn't be doing, right? But Umar insisted. He was so upset, he was so stressed out that he couldn't understand that. So what happened? Sayyidina Abu Bakr then gets on the minbar, right? He stands up and then he starts to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And he starts to talk. And he said in his famous words, whoever used to worship Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad has died. Whoever worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is ever living and will never die. Then recited the verse, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِن مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ قَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ أَعْقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَيْهِ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ. Right, that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not but a messenger. Other messengers have passed on before him. So if he was to die or to be killed, would you turn your hand over your backs or on your heels to unbelief? Would you turn back to the practice that you have left? And he who turns back on his heels will never harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at all. Right? This shows us that when we do our practice, right, we do our prayers, we do our zakah, we have good friends for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we spend time in the masjid, even if a lecture is very tiring, right, we listen to it and we try to learn and benefit, right, we're doing it for ourselves. We don't benefit Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we're here. We only benefit ourselves, right? We increase our own iman. We get our own good deeds, right? So Allah, the ayah says, Allah will reward the grateful. Umar, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala, he is a hafiz of the Qur'an. And he's like that. I felt like when he recited that verse, that was the first time I ever heard that verse, right? And he said, by Allah, as soon as I heard Abu Bakr recite that verse, I fell to the ground as my legs would not support me, right? And I realized that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has passed away, right? And all you would hear in the masjid is crying, right? But it brought the Muslims back to their senses and united the Ummah again. Because you would think, Abu Bakr, being that close friend, right? If we look at our own families today and we lost maybe our parents, and we lost one of our siblings, right? We would be very sad, we would be very emotional, we'd be very weak and vulnerable, right? But Abu Bakr wasn't. He was a leader, and he stepped up to the plate when he needed to. رضي الله تعالى عنه. The fifth event that shows the bravery and the superior knowledge of the Siddiq رضي الله تعالى عنه occurred 3 days after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. It wasn't too long after the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. On the third day when he got the Khilafah, that same day, he sent out the army of Osama bin Zayd. Or he wanted to send out the army of Osama bin Zayd. This one, inshallah, this question is easy. Because I got some feedback and people are saying I made the questions too hard. So I apologize. But how old was Osama bin Zayd? And this one is really important. Like, this one will relate to all of us. Maybe I'm a little bit older than that now, but it still relates to all of us. No, Anis, you already answered the question. One of the sisters, can you give me an answer, please? Take a guess, like an age number. What is it? Close, like super close. 16. Jazakumullah khairan. Yes, he was 16 years old. And Osama bin Zayd was put in charge to lead the army of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And where was he put in charge to lead? Was he put in charge to go to like a small village of like 10, 15 people? And try to go fight the battles over there? Where was he put in charge for? It was the superpower of that day, the Byzantine Empire. The Byzantine Empire, the superpower of that time, right? So the Prophet ﷺ, unfortunately, after he passed, he couldn't send out the army. And Sayyidina Abu Bakr is like, no, I am going to send out this army. I don't care. And as mentioned earlier, Medina was very vulnerable. Everybody was still sad. They were still recovering, right? They were still trying to comprehend what just happened. And then Abu Bakr comes and he's like, guys, get ready. You gotta go. You gotta leave, right? And they got scared. They're like, who's gonna protect Medina? Who's gonna protect the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Who's gonna protect it? What if Medina gets compromised, right? So they had one meeting and nothing came to agreement, right? And this sounds like the Muslims today. When we all meet with each other, we have meetings, we never really agree on something. Someone always has some opinion, and then someone has another opinion, and then we all just say, dude, forget it, I'm kind of upset, and I'm just going to leave, right? Then they had a second meeting. No one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, right? None of the companions sided with Abu Bakr. Everyone's like, no, we cannot go out, this is not the right thing to do, right? So when all the odds were against Sayyidina Abu Bakr, right? And no companion took his side. What did Abu Bakr do? Did he just give up? Right? If someone comes and tells us that we're wrong, right? But we have evidence, we have a good understanding, we know what we're doing, and someone tells us, no, we're wrong, should we just give up? No. We shouldn't give up. We should put our effort. We should put our knowledge to work in action, right? So he radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, and this is a very beautiful statement, he said, by the one in whose hand is the soul of Abu Bakr, even if I thought that a wild animal would come and snatch me, I would still send the army of Osama, as instructed by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even if there was no one left in the city but me, if I was the only man left in the city, I would still send that. Send the army. Because this was a command of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was the right decision, and the companions would come to know of. So then they're like, okay, fine, we lost one battle. They sent Sayyidina Umar to Abu Bakr, and they're like, yeah, Umar, you're the closest to Abu Bakr. That's your homeboy. Go talk to your homeboy and tell him that the Ansar want someone else to command the army. Osama bin Zayd, 16 years old. He's not a, by our standards, he's not a grown man. But he was the man of men, radiallahu ta'ala. By our standards today, 16, yeah, it seems like that. But because we're just, you know, we're little babies compared to the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To put it in the nicest way. Right? He was a man of men, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So they said, okay, Umar, go talk to him. And what did Umar do? He's like, okay, I'll go talk to him. I'll go talk to Abu Bakr, right? And he went to the Siddiq and he said, the Ansar are asking for a man who is older than Musama to lead the army. What do you think the reply of Abu Bakr was? He already argued with them about dispatching the army, and he was right. What do you think the reply of Abu Bakr was? Do you think he was happy? Or do you think he was upset? He was upset, right? He was sitting down when Umar came in. And what did I tell you guys, right? Abu Bakr is medium to short height. Sayyidina Umar is a towering figure that when you see the man, you get like scared seeing him. Or you get intimidated at least, right? He's built, he's a big guy. He comes in, he has a very stern voice. And inshallah, Dr. Hamid will talk. I'm not going to get too many details of Sayyidina Umar because then you guys will blame me. You'll be like, Shahid talked about Umar too much, right? But he was a very firm and stern person. And when he came in and said that, Abu Bakr got up right away. And he took a hold of Sayyidina Umar's beard and he said, may your mother lose you, O son of Khattab. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam appointed him and you are telling me to dismiss him? You're telling me to go against the commandment that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had put? What does this show? That Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala was keen on the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whether we are a male, whether we are a female, whether we are young, whether we are old, whether we have a smart, big intellect, right? Whether we're people that question everything, right? Whether we are people that we might feel like we're not smart, and I'm in that category, right? I don't think I'm smart, right? But it doesn't matter. If you follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will be successful in this world and the next. And this is what Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala time and time and time again showed. That if you follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the full extent, right? As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what does he say in the Quran? He says, "Udkhulu fi silmi kafa wa la tattabi'u khutuwati ash-shaytan." Enter into the deen, right? Completely, with complete and full submission, and do not follow the footsteps of the shaytan, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us this, right? And what did Allah tell us about our beautiful religion? He told us that he has perfected it. There's nothing deficient in our religion that someone can come and tell me today, oh Shahid, your religion is deficient in this, 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 and that. Oh, your women are oppressed. Oh, your men are abusive. Or this or that. Yes, we have many issues. I'm not trying to go into that. I'm not trying to open a can of worms. What I'm trying to say is in general terms. Like, please understand that. So that someone says, Shahid said this, this, and that, and this is what he meant. No, I'm talking about it in very general terms. I'm talking about it in the sense of how the media portrays us, right? Because every time they say something negative, right, they always try to put us down. They're never going to say Islam is a great religion. No one's going to go and accept you the way you are. Especially if you are a practicing person, no one's going to accept you. They're going to call you extremist. They're going to call you so many names. They're going to make fun of you. You might not make the most friends. You might not get the highest paying jobs. When you go for promotions at work, you might not get the promotion just because of that. But that's your choice. You have to decide who you are. You have to decide what you live for, what you stand for, who you want to be, who do you want to be recognized for, what legacy do you want to leave. You want to leave a legacy that pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or do you want to leave a legacy that only pleases other people? If you want to please other people, no one's going to stop you. The Prophet ﷺ told us in an authentic hadith that do as you wish. Pretty much, I'm trying to summarize this. SubhanAllah, actually, it just like went away from my head as soon as I thought about it. Right? But it's an authentic hadith in the Arba'in al-Nawwi, the 40 hadith of Imam Nawawi. And I can't recall it, but it summarizes that do as you wish. If you're not going to listen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as Rasul, then do as you wish. But wait for that time when death comes to you. And death does not discriminate. It doesn't look at how old I am, how old you guys are, how old you guys are. It doesn't look at that. It doesn't look at your race, your religion, your color, your status, right? If you're a happy person, if you're a sad person, if you're a smart person, if you're not intelligent at all, and all of us are intelligent. All of us are intelligent, all of us are beautiful, all of us are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created, and He loves us very much, okay? All of us are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves us very much, and He wants us to repent to Him. But it doesn't matter, death doesn't discriminate. And death will come and take us at any time. We're not guaranteed life on this earth long as a long time. Yes, we know from the hadiths of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that my ummah will live from 60 to 70. Yes, we understand that. But we can see many people have passed before us, right? Whether it's our family members, whether it's our friends. And I know many people even in this community at a young age, they passed away. They passed away. So it's not guaranteed. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was keen on the sunnah. So Umar left the meeting and the people asked him, what happened, Ya Umar? Sayyidina Umar got so upset. He's like, may your mothers lose you guys. He said the same thing. Abu Bakr said to him, he's like, may your mothers lose you. You got the Siddiq angry at me. This is how much Umar loved Abu Bakr. Because he knew the status of Abu Bakr. So when Abu Bakr would get mad, Sayyidina Umar would feel upset. Because he's like, this is a man that is the closest to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sayyidina Umar even himself said that and this is also in the hadith, that if the iman of Abu Bakr is on one side, the iman of the whole ummah is on the other, the iman of Abu Bakr is higher. The iman of Abu Bakr is higher. So a small side note, when Abu Bakr walked the army, right? He walked the army. Abu Sa'd bin Zayd, he turned to the Muslims and he gave them 10 instructions. He said, and I want everyone to pay attention and teach people these 10 lessons. Many Muslims and non-Muslims, when they think about our history, when they look at us today, unfortunately we have people across the world doing things in the name of Islam, which is not Islamic at all. Right? We're not even supposed to kill an animal, right, unjustly. We're not even supposed to kill ants and spiders unjustly, right? But then you have people that are claiming to kill people in the name of Islam, right? And he gave these 10 instructions. And I want all of us to pay attention to these 10 instructions and teach other people these 10 instructions, because these would help clear many misconceptions. As Abu Bakr was walking with Osama bin Zayd radiallahu ta'ala anhum, he turned to the army and said, Oh people, stop that I may advise you of 10 things. Learn them from me. Do not betray. Do not steal from the spoils of war. Do not stab in the back. Do not mutilate. Do not cut down fruit-bearing trees. And do not slaughter any sheep or cow or camel unless you want to eat. You will pass by some people who have devoted themselves to worship in hermitages, which are the monks, right? They worship the asceticism. I don't even know if I said that word right, but I hope I'm close. Leave them to what they had devoted themselves to. You will come to people who will bring you vessels with different types of food. If you eat anything, mention the name of Allah over it. You will meet people who have shaved the middle of their heads and left what is around it like bands. Strike them hard with the sword, because they are your enemies. Those are the people that they were going to fight. And he said, march forward in the name of Allah. So think about that. You can't go, if you go there, you can't even cut a tree down for the sake of just cutting a tree down. This is how disciplined the Muslims' armies were. But unfortunately today, right, people just think that we're barbaric people. Right? They think that we, if we have a certain name, we have a certain appearance, we have a certain ideology, that we just want to kill everybody. Astaghfirullah. May Allah protect us from this. right? So we have to work hard, my brothers and sisters. This is what I'm trying to tell you. And many of you, inshallah, when you get older and you get your job and you graduate and all these things, you will start to see what I'm trying to talk about. Because when you go to your work and you try to practice your faith, people automatically have a pre-misconception about you. They already have that pre-misconception. No matter what you try to do, you will never, ever please the people completely. Someone will have an issue with you, no matter what is the case. You could be the kindest person. You could give them gifts. You could give them hugs and this and all that, right? But it doesn't matter. They will still not accept you as who you completely are, right? And that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said in a hadith, he said, "Bil ghariban, ghariban, fasayyudu ghariban kama bada, fatuba lil ghuraba." That this religion started as something strange, and it will return. It will return as something strange. So glad tidings, tuba lil ghuraba. And what does tuba mean? Our ulama, they give us two explanations, right? One is that it's a tree in Jannah, right? It's a specific tree in Jannah, and the second is that it is glad tidings. Glad tidings to the strangers. And our brothers and sisters, we are strangers in this time, and we are becoming strangers. Especially the ones that we try to portray our faith like on our chest, on our heart. The ones that show that, right? The sixth and the last one for this specific category of bravery and strength and admonition of Sayyidina Abu Bakr is the one that shows his superior knowledge, even though we have many more, is the battle against the Murtadeen. The Muslims did not want to pay the zakat to Abu Bakr. So after the Prophet ﷺ died, right, they did not want to pay zakat to Abu Bakr. They're like, we would pay it. We paid it to the Prophet ﷺ, but we're not going to pay it to you. And some of them even mocked Abu Bakr. They said, oh, he's the father of the young camel, right? And one of the companions, he said, wallah, you're going to regret it. He's going to show you that he's the father of the stallion. And he did, right? And that's just a metaphor, right? Obviously, he's not a stallion, but it's just a metaphor to understand the man, the type of leadership and the command that Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu had. And I'm really summarizing this part. Alhamdulillah, Sheikh Ali left because Sheikh Ali is the one that taught me these words. He said, in a golden statement, أَيَنْفُسْ هَدَ الدِّينَ وَأَنَا حَيْفِ. Do you think I am going to let this religion decrease while I am alive? So these people, they paid zakat when the Prophet ﷺ was here, and I swear by Allah, they will pay zakat while I am the Khalifa. He said, I swear by Allah, they will pay as long as I am alive. I will not let this religion decrease. And this is something, a statement that I want us all to take. If this is the only statement you get out of my whole time I've been talking, أَيَنْقُسْ هَذَا الدِّينَ وَأَنَا حَيْءٍ, that will this religion decrease while each of us are alive here? No, by Allah, it should not. And if it does, that's because of our deficiencies. I mean, the deen, in a sense, will not decrease ever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has already protected this deen. But what I'm trying to say is that for us, we have to become strong men and women. We have to be people that are independent, and we have to understand how to portray our faith to other people. Right? Islam is not just a personal thing, what you have in your heart. Right? It's not just a personal thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَعْمَالِكُمْ, right? قُلُوبُكُمْ وَعَمَالِكُمْ, that what's in your heart and what is in your actions, right? It's the hadith we mentioned. So again, the companions of the Prophet ﷺ didn't agree with Abu Bakr. Sayyidina Umar, he came and he said, قَالَ عُمَرْ بْنَ خَطَّابِ لِأَبُو بَكْرٍ كَيْفَ تُقَاتِلُ النَّاسَ وَقَدْ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أُقَاتِلَ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَقُولُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَمَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ فَقَدْ عَصَمَ مِنِّي مَالَهُ وَنَفْسَهُ إِلَّا بِحَقِّ وَحِسَابُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Right? فَقَالَ أَبُو بَكْرٍ وَاللَّهِ لَأُقَاتِلَنَّ مَنْ فَرَّقَ بَيْنَ الصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ فَإِنَّ الزَّكَاةَ حَقُّ الْمَالِ وَاللَّهِ لَوْ مَنَعُونِي عِقَالًا كَانُوا يُوَدُّونَ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَقَاتَلْتُهُمْ عَلَى مَنْعِهِ. فقال عمر بن الخطاب فوالله ما هو إلا أن رأيت الله الزوج قد شرح صدر أبي بكر للقتال فعرفت أنه الحق. Right? That why would you fight against the people when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam declared, I have been directed to fight against people so long as they do not say that there is no God but Allah, and he who professed it was granted full protection of his property and life on behalf, except for a right. of other affairs with the rest of, except for a right. His other affairs rest with Allah, right? So if someone said, La ilaha illallah, that Umar is trying to explain to Abu Bakr that if someone said, La ilaha illallah, then he's protected, right? And that the rest of his affairs are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Umar is saying, if they're not paying zakat, that they will soften their hearts and will come back. Abu Bakr said, by Allah, I would definitely fight against him who severed prayer from zakat. For it is the obligation upon the rich. By Allah, I would fight against them to secure the cord used for hobbling the feet of a camel, which they used to give to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam as zakat, but now they have withheld it. Umar ibn Khattab remarked, by Allah, I found nothing but the fact that Allah has opened the heart of Abu Bakr for perceiving the justification of fighting against those who refuse to pay zakat, and I fully recognize that the stand of Abu Bakr was right. Radiallahu ta'ala an. Right, so this is another instance where the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, they disagreed with Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr ended up being right. So what some of the armies they did, right, or some of the tribes, they ended up coming back and they paid the zakat. And then the rest that apostated, the Muslim army went had battles with them. And you also had the false prophets at this time that came up, and we will not talk about that because that's its own lecture series in itself. Right, a lot of these things, what I really want you guys to get from this is I'm really just super summarizing all these points in the life of Abu Bakr, right? And I want you guys yourself to go and learn about Abu Bakr more or any of the companions that you are interested in, right? And I just want to throw out as much knowledge in this short period of time. As like I said, these lecture series are for hours, hours, hours. So you have this is one of the two stances that our scholars say that kept the religion in its pure form. Right? And one of the biggest stances in the history of Islam. Does anyone know the second? So the first one is of Abu Bakr against the Murtadeen, the people paying zakat. What's the second one? Now this is, I know, is a tough question. But Osama, can I talk on your behalf? And Osama might give you $100. No, he's not even here. Okay. So that doesn't work. Okay. This is one of the great scholars. So this is not a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, this is after his time. So our ulama, they say there's two stances. The first one is from Abu Bakr, who's the second one?
Is it that one guy who compiled all the hadith?
There's many scholars that compiled the hadith. You're right. Okay, I'll give one name. He has his own Musnad. Yes. Jazakumullah khairan. So the Musnad of Imam Ahmed. And what was his stance of Imam Ahmed? Does anyone know? What was the topic of his time? It had to do with the Book of Allah. What was the topic of his time? Yes, Haris. Yes, the makhluq al-Qur'an, right? The Mu'tazila, they said that the Qur'an is the creation of Allah, it's not the speech of Allah, right? And Imam Ahmed went against this. And this is our scholars saying these are the two stances that kept Islam to reach us till today as a purified form. So the point I want to make from the last scenario, and I kind of mentioned it a few times, but I think it's so important, right, is that hold strongly onto this deen. One of the things I've noticed, right, a lot too, is why do people sometimes leave this deen, unfortunately, right? Because they take this religion as something that is a cultural practice. They don't take it as something that they own, that it should be something in their heart, right? It's not something that they take with pride. So when we take this religion as a cultural practice, something that our parents have taught us, that's something that our parents were taught from their parents, right? Then we will not really appreciate this religion. We will start to question it. We will start to ask more questions until the shaitan starts to confuse us. And once he starts to confuse us, right? Once he starts to confuse us, we start getting away from the religion. We think like, man, this thing here looks off. Oh no, this one, I don't agree with that. I don't like that. You know? I gotta pray 5 times a day. You tell me I gotta wake up at 4:50, like 4 in the morning, right? Things like that. I know that's an extreme case. But anyways, it's just a realistic, it's a reality. None of us are perfect. We all have our sins. We all have our mistakes. We all look better in the public than we are in the private, unfortunately. right? All of us, we look better to people in the public than we are in the private, right? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows He is the most merciful. So that's one point I want to make sure that we take, that do not take this religion as a cultural practice, but understand that this is something we need to take with pride, hold it, put it in our heart, and continue to learn about it, love it, and teach it to other people. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And who is better in speech than the one who invites to Allah and does righteousness and says, indeed, right? It says, indeed. It's not just, وَقَالَ أَنَا مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. And indeed, I am from the Muslims. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us amongst them. Say ameen. The second characteristic, and I'm going to start going a little bit quicker because it's 8:55, and I spent a lot more time. So I prepared 21 pages of content. Alhamdulillah, I got through 16 of them, but I thought I was going to go through a lot quicker. So alhamdulillah, we've been going. The second one is very famous. It's very easy. It's the charity of Sayyidina Abu Bakr. It is the charity. And just because some of us may live at home with the family or with the parents or this or that or might not have jobs, do not underestimate your charity. Do not underestimate the amount you give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let me give you an example. Let's say you give you have $10 in your bank account. You might be like, dang, I'm a broke person. And that could be true. You might be broke, right? From certain terms, okay? Doesn't mean you're poor. You might just be broke at that time. Right? But if you give $1, or let's say you give $5, out of that $10 out of your account, how much percent is that of your total wealth? Alhamdulillah, that's a good question. Everybody answered. That's good. 50%. That's 50% of your wealth. So do you think that you will have less reward than someone who has $1 million and they only give $200? You think you'll have less reward? No. You gave a greater amount, you sacrificed it. Yes, when you have more money, it's a more of a test, right? And a lot of you, inshallah, you'll become successful, you'll become rich, inshallah, you'll make a lot of money, and inshallah, in 10 years, when I see you guys down the road, I will say, hey, give $1,000, and I hope you guys give it to me easily, right? I'm not counting on it. Okay. I'm not counting on it, but I want you guys to remember, right, to give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So one of the other ayahs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed of Abu Bakr calling him al-Atqa, right? Sorry, this note was bothering me. I just read it again. So one of the other names of Abu Bakr is al-Atqa, right? And how did he get this name? So in the beginning of Islam, during the da'wah, he only came, I believe, with 40 dinar, right? He came, and what did he start to do? He started to free the Muslims. Who was the most famous of the Muslims that he freed? And I'll give you, actually I want to give a hint. So if I give a hint, everybody knows. Yes, Jazakumullah khairan, Sayyidina Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He's the most famous, right? Even Abu Bakr in his da'wah, he has 5 of the 10 that are given the glad tidings of Jannah, came to Islam through Abu Bakr. So what did Abu Bakr do? He would start to free so many people, and he would free the ones that are very low status in society, they're weak, they don't have a lot of money. So his father saw this. His father said, oh, Abu Bakr, right? Why are you freeing all the weak slaves, quote unquote, right? Why don't you free the strong ones that they can help you, that they can give you protection? And what did Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu say? He said, oh my father, all I seek is to do what Allah wants. And who do you think was pleased to hear this? No other than the ones in the heavens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, and I'll just translate it because we don't have a lot of time, and far removed from it, from the hellfire, will be the one who is pious, an atqa, right? Fearful, who spends his wealth for increase in self-purification and has in mind no favor from anyone for which a reward is expected in return, right? Except only to desire the countenance of his Lord. So he's not looking for any reward. لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا إِنَّ نَخَافُ مِنْ رَبِّنَا يَوْمًا عَبُوسًا قَمْطَرِيرًا. Right? That we don't ask thankful, we don't look for the reward except for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu says, وَلَا سَوْفَ يَرْضَى. Right? Sorry, I said 2 different verses. So I hope the verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed for Abu Bakr is in Surah Al-Layl. The ones that I said was Al-Insan is similar meaning, so that's why I just related that. I hope everybody gets that clearly. So Allah gave him this name, Al-Atqa. Do you think Abu Bakr only gave it a time of ease, or did he give it a time of hardship? What do you guys think? in both, right? So when his daughter was accused of was slandered, right, of committing a very hideous act, Sayyida Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, one of his cousins, was also part of spreading that rumor. What did Sayyidina Abu Bakr then, once her innocence came, and I'm really paraphrasing, I'm trying to go through all the pages I have, that he said, I will not give this man sadaqah anymore, because he used to give it regularly, right? He got very upset that he accused my daughter of doing something very wrong, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved him very much. He revealed the verse, and let not those of virtue among you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling him a person of virtue. Among you in wealth, swear not to give aid to their relatives and the needy and the immigrants for the cause of Allah. And let them pardon and overlook. Right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Would you not want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to pardon you? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, most forgiving and most merciful. So after hearing this, Abu Bakr said, by Allah, I will give this man the charity. I forgive him, and I would love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive me. The last one, and it's a very famous hadith that we all know, and this is when one day Sayyidina Umar and all the companions, they knew the fada'il, the virtues of the Sayyidina Abu Bakr. They're like, one day the Prophet is asking for money, and this hadith, I think all of us, or many of us, we know, Sayyidina Umar was like, okay, man, I'm tired, this guy beats me every time, right? Huwa sabbaqun li kulli khayr. He's always, everything about him is good. He's always beating me. So today, I have some money, I'm going to go. So he goes to the Prophet ﷺ, and the Prophet ﷺ asks him, what are you bringing? He's like, I brought half of my wealth, Ya Rasulullah ﷺ, and I left half of it for my family. Right? I left half of it for my family. Then he sees Abu Bakr coming. And Abu Bakr brings his amount. And the Prophet ﷺ asks Abu Bakr, right, that Abu Bakr, how much have you left for your family? Ya Abu Bakr, ma abqaita li ahlin? Qala abqaita lahum Allah wa rasuluh. Qultu wallahi la asbiquhu ila shay'in abada. Right? He said that I have left Allah and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam for my family. He brought all of his wealth. So Umar, Sayyidina Umar, after this day, he's like, I am not going to beat this guy. By Allah, I cannot beat this guy. This guy has something that he has special about him, and he definitely did, Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So continue to give for the sake of Allah. Allah will reward you, He will multiply for you, and He will protect you from poverty and all these other things. The last characteristic that I want to talk about, the Siddiq, was when he became Khalifa, right? When he left it, when after Prophet ﷺ died, before he became Khalifa, he would used to go to this blind woman, and he used to milk her cows, right? Take care of all her chores and things like that. Do you think after he became Khalifa, he changed? No. He still did it after he became Khalifa. Because one time when he was walking, one of the girls came and said, oh, Abu Bakr's not going to take care of our cows anymore. He's not going to take care of these chores. And Abu Bakr said, by Allah, I hope that does not happen to me. And he took care of that even when he was the Khalifa. And the last point, and I want to try to set it up for next week. And the best one for this is him leaving Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala, or him appointing Sayyidina Umar as the Khalifa after him. This was the best thing to happen after the death of Abu Bakr for this Ummah. As we know, as we will come to learn the things that Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu did. Abdurrahman ibn Auf, he made shura and he asked when he was sick, he's like, what do you think of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, or Sayyidina Umar? He said, he is better than you think he is. Uthman ibn Affan said, by Allah, I know what he conceals is better than what he shows, except for Talha ibn Ubaidillah. He said, are you leaving that man who's very harsh as our leadership? What are you going to say to your Lord, Ya Abu Bakr? And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he had a short time. Right, that's one thing. He had a short temper, but he would always come back to forgive. He said, he said, sit me up. Are you trying to make me fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He said that. Any ruler who does you wrong is doomed. I will say, oh Allah, I appointed over them the best of your people. Right? And then he explained, Sayyidina Umar is only harsh and strict because I am very soft and lenient. So then he made Umar ibn Khattab the Khalifa. And he gave some advice and made supplication for him. He said, I have appointed him not on the basis of the command of your prophet. I did not intend anything thereby, but seeking what is in their best interest. I fear turmoil for them, and I have thought long and hard about this matter. I have appointed over them the best of them, and the one who is the most keen to lead them in the right way. Now here, I am with your decree about to be fulfilled. Take care of them after I'm gone, for they are your slaves. This was the dua he made Sayyidina Abu Bakr right before he passed. And subhanAllah, what does it remind us of? It reminds us of the Prophet ﷺ. As the Prophet ﷺ, when he was passing over, what did he say? He said, ummati, ummati, ummati. Right? He was always thinking about his ummah. And inshallah, next week you will hear about this great man, Omar ibn Khattab, from our brother, Dr. Muhammad Hakim. So in conclusion, last points. Do not underestimate yourself and your ability, and just listen to these last points. Because maybe in this lecture I was talking too fast, maybe I said too many things, and I know sometimes that when I get in the mode, like I get hyped, I just start going, and I can't stop. You know, so because this is something I love, alhamdulillah, so it's, may Allah accept. So do not underestimate yourself and your ability. You are able to accomplish whatever you put your mind to. Be brave on this religion with pride. Donate for the sake of Allah, and do not think that your wealth will decrease, as this is a promise from the Prophet ﷺ, that what Allah ﷻ has told us. Love this ummah more than you love yourself. Love the ummah, love the service of other people more than what you love for yourself. And think good of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the hadith, Qudsi, I am as my slave thinks of me. And I will end in the advice of the from our Siddiq, from our companion, the beloved of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, that he says, Allah does not accept any deeds except those which are done for his sake. Seek Allah by your deeds, for you usually show sincerity during the time of poverty and need. Learn a lesson, O slaves of Allah, from those who have died, and think about those who came before you, where they were yesterday and where they are today. Where are the powerful who were known for fighting and prevailing in times of war? They have passed away and turned to dust. They were joined by their evil spouses. Where are the kings who developed the land and built high structures? They are long gone and have been forgotten. They have become nothing, but Allah will hold them accountable for their deeds. They are gone and their deeds are still their own, but their worldly adornments have gone to someone else. Other people who have came after them. If we learn a lesson from them, we will be saved. But if we sink to their level, we will become like them. Where are the bright, shining faces who admired themselves for their youth? They have turned to dust, and because of their negligence, they ended up with regret. Where are the kings who built cities and fortified them with walls, filling them with wonders? They left them to those who came after them. Their dwellings are empty, and they are in the darkness of the grave. Where are your fathers and brothers? Their lives have ended, and they have gone to what they sent on ahead and settled there, either in the place of doom or in a place of bliss after death. There is none worthy of worship other than Allah, with no partner or associate. There is no connection between him and any of his creation that makes him grant good or ward off evil, except obedience to him and following his command. Remember that you are slaves who will be brought to account, and that what is with him cannot be attained except by obeying him. Is it not time for you to be saved from the fire and get close to paradise? وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خيرا.